Thank you. Thank you. What an honor. What an honor to be here. You may be seated. Baron, I had no idea when we were over at Cottonwood making those recordings that all this would happen. 340,000 people. Wow. How many of you know it's good to sow seed? It is good to sow seed. And I'm touched for those of you who are involved in ISOM around the world. God bless you. I preached 5 messages in there, and those messages have caught up with me as I travel around the world. I arrived in Iraq, maybe 20 years ago, and someone called me by name. And I had no idea why they would know my name, because I'd never been there. And they said, well, you were here on an ISOM video. And so I found out I was known somewhere I didn't know anybody else. Interesting, really interesting. But privileged to be here to share with you tonight. Before I minister, I'm going to tell you a story. I work 30 miles from the ISIS lines in northern Iraq. A couple months back, I had a young warrior ask if he could talk with me. I was on my way out of the country in the middle of the evening to fly to Amman, Jordan, on to Chicago and home. The young man was a Peshmerga fighter. In fact, he'd been fighting ISIS the day before. We met in a Muslim hotel. I said, why do you want to talk to me, to see me? He said, well, I want to tell you a story. He said, 3 weeks ago, I was doing the guard duty in the middle of the night against ISIS. He said, by the way, they are the most fearsome fighters you can imagine. They come screaming, cursing in the Arab language across the desert with their machine guns blazing. And he said, I was there watching one night, and I was so tired when I got back to lay down on my mattress on the desert. He said, I had a deep dream. I fell into a deep sleep and had a dream. In the dream, he said, a beautiful, brilliant being, spiritual being, appeared to me in the dream. And he reached out and took me by the hand, and in the dream we walked over a hill and down to a beautiful oasis. He said, 2 nights later, I had another dream, and this time I had a little boy and a little girl in both my hands, and this same being came and led us over the hill. But he said, why I'm talking to you tonight, he said, is 3 days ago we chased ISIS out of a village. He said, they are the best booby trappers in the world. They always leave their signature behind with IEDs. He said, when we go into a new captured village, the first thing we do is clean the thing for bombs and whatever else is there. And he said, he said 3 days ago, I went into the village with my soldiers, and he said the commander told me to go and check a certain house. He said, I walked over to the house, reached out my hand to open the door. And he said, this brilliant being was not in my dream anymore. He was standing beside me as I reached out my hand. And he held my hand and he said, don't open the door. He said, 2 hours later, a couple of young men opened that door and were blown into eternity. He said, what has been happening to me? My first question to him was this. I said, is anybody praying for you? He said, yes. My sister became a Christian about 5 years ago, and she won't stop praying. She's praying night and day. And I said, well, that's your problem. He said, what do you mean? I said, well, what you've been seeing are angels. And angels appear when people pray, when Christians pray. And that's an angel of the Lord. He said, well, what in the world am I going to do? I said, well, I've got an idea. He said, what is that? And I said, I'd like you to pray a prayer with me, and I'd like to introduce you to Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I had an opportunity to minister to him there at the table. Now, understand, this is in a Muslim hotel. Muslim waitresses and men moving back and forth. And we bowed, he prayed, opened his eyes. There was a big smile on his face. 3 days later, I got a call from Iraq that told me Marco was his name. Marco is now a follower of Jesus. Here's the announcement. Here's the announcement. In the Middle East, and these numbers are firm, 90% of people coming to Jesus in the Middle East are seeing supernatural signs of one kind or another. It is absolutely amazing. God, let me tell you, if God starts moving in some part of the world and starts appearing to people, you better open your eyes and look, because he's got a plan for wherever that's going on. And I'm here to tell you tonight that God is going to deal with ISIS. We're in the middle of it. I believe the greatest revival the world's ever seen is going to come in the Middle East, and it's going to come soon. And I want to be a part of it. That's why we're there. My son is over there all the time. We take care. We feed 4,500 refugees every day in our work, working out of Erbil, the capital of Iraq. So it's an honor to be here and to tell you what God is doing. But I want to read a Bible story to you right now. It's one of my favorites, taken out of the Old Testament in the book of Genesis, chapter 24. I'm going to read four verses, the first part of the chapter. This is a brilliant chapter. The Holy Spirit opened this up to me 2 to 3 years ago, and I was amazed at what I saw here. But I want to read it to you. Now, Abraham was old, well advanced in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. So Abraham said to the oldest servant of his house, who ruled over all that he had, "Please, put your hand under my thigh, and I will make you swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that you will not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell, but you shall go to my country and to my family and take a wife for my son Isaac." Verse 10. Then the servant took 10 of his master's camels and departed. For all of his master's goods were in his hand, and he arose and went to Mesopotamia, to the city of Nahor. And he made his camels kneel down outside the city by a well of water at evening time, the time when women go out to draw water. Then he said, "O Lord God of my master Abraham, please give me success today and show kindness to my master Abraham. Behold, here I stand at the well of water, and the daughters of the men of the city are coming out to draw water. Now let it be that the young woman to whom I say, 'Please let down your pitcher that I may drink,' and she says, 'Drink,' and I will also give your camels a drink. Let her be the one you've appointed for your servant Isaac. And by this I will know that you have shown kindness to my master." I love the next phrase, and it says, "And it happened." Isn't that nice? In the middle of a prayer, it happens before you've even finished it. Wow. Anyway, it happened. Before he had finished speaking, behold, Rebekah, who was born to came out with her pitcher on her shoulder. And the young woman was very beautiful to behold, a virgin, no man had known her. She went down to the well, filled her pitcher, and came up. And the servant ran to meet her and said, "Please let me drink a little water from your pitcher." So she said, "Drink, my lord." Then she quickly let her pitcher down in her hand and gave him a drink. And when she'd finished giving him a drink, she said, "I will draw water for your camels also until they have finished drinking." Then she quickly emptied her pitcher into the trough, ran back to the well to draw water, and drew for all his camels. Anybody in San Bernardino, California, know how much water a camel drinks? Who's been on the desert for a long time? 40 gallons. We're talking about a little lady with a pail drawing water for 4,000 pounds of water for the camels of Abraham's servant. Now, I want to suggest to you that this story is not so much a love story. I've heard it preached on in various ways. But some time ago, as I was studying the scripture, I saw something. I can't even describe what it was. I suggest to you this evening that this story is a parable about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. You say, how in the world do you get that out of the text? I'll tell you how. I believe there's a picture of redemption in this story. Abraham is a picture of God the Father. Isaac is a picture of Jesus, the Son of God. Rebecca is a picture of the church, the bride of Christ. And the unnamed servant is a picture of the Holy Spirit. Look at it this way. Just as God the Father and God the Son sent Jesus on the day of Pentecost and poured the Holy Spirit out upon mankind, in the same way, Abraham is a picture of God the Father. What is he wanting? He's wanting a bride for his son. And I would suggest to you that the primary driving force and mandate that the Father and the Son have left with the Spirit is bring home a bride. Heaven is waiting for a bride, and that is your mission. We have loved the gifts of the Spirit, and I thank God for those. We watch them, and we are excited by them. But the Holy Spirit did not come primarily just to bring gifts. He has done that, and we honor the power of God in that. But I want you to look a little deeper, if you would, with me tonight to his mission. Heaven is waiting. The bridegroom is standing, waiting. All of eternity is waiting for the bride. And the Holy Spirit is here now, doing his work and fulfilling the commission that God the Father has given him. It's interesting to me when you... let me give you a little history on the story. This girl, Rebecca, had no idea who this servant was. She didn't even know that her uncle Abraham was still alive. They had seen him disappear 50 years ago. They didn't know if he was alive or dead. And all of a sudden, his servant shows up at the well and says, Uncle Abraham's alive. Well, Rebecca took off from the well. She went running back to her house, and she running through the house. Abraham's alive. Abraham's alive. And her older brother, Laban, wanted to find out. So he runs back to the well. And here is this man waiting. The girl has watered his camels. Everything is done. But he's just standing there. And Laban says, who are you? And he told him the story. He said, come into our house. So when they brought him into the house and said, why have you come all the way across the desert? And he said, I've come to find a bride for Isaac. Isaac is now 40 years of age, and his father Abraham does not want a wife for him from the Canaanites among which they dwell. He wants someone from his hometown, and here I am looking for a wife. And he said to the congregation in the house, he said, the funniest thing happened to me. He said, when I arrived at the well an hour ago, or however long, he said, I prayed a prayer. I've come here for a wife, and I prayed specifically to God, and I said, God, may the young woman that draws the water for my camels, may she be the one you have chosen as a bride for Isaac. And no sooner were the words out of my mouth than here comes this beautiful young lady, Rebecca, and she not only draws water for me, she draws water for 10 camels. If Rebecca is a picture of the church, think of it for a moment. What kind of bride is the Holy Spirit looking for the Son? A pretty little lady that sits on the front seat with a polite smile of praise and worship on her lips? Or do you think he's looking for a bride that will put the water, the pail of salvation down into the well and pull up the waters so that people can hear and know and understand what God is doing in the world today. Would somebody say amen? I believe that with all my heart. Now, that's the story of redemption. And Abraham came through his son, or through his servant, Isaac, and made the request. Just think of it. Let me go back and say it again. 40 days after Jesus arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven. And 10 days later, the Holy Spirit was poured out on the day of Pentecost. Same picture, same story. Abraham's servant came with gifts, just as the Holy Spirit. And now the Holy Spirit is here with a passion in his heart for the lost. Because whether we understand it or not, God loves mankind. God loves the lost. And he is determined to bring in the harvest. And we are living in important days because I believe the harvest is being drawn in even now by the power of the Spirit of God. Let me talk to the women in the audience for a moment tonight. How many of you ladies would be, number one, would be willing to go with a man that, or first of all, number one, how many women would be willing to get on a camel? They are God's most obstreperous creature. They're just flat out miserable and mean and ugly. I've ridden them at the pyramids and other places around the world, and they're not a happy camper, believe me. So, first of all, ladies, would you be willing to get on a camel? Number two, would you be willing to go with a man that you've known for less than 24 hours? Think of how ridiculous this is. And number three, would you travel through 300 miles of pirate-infested desert? Number four, to marry a man you've never seen? Number five, to live forever in a foreign land and never see your family again? How many women would be up for that here tonight in the service? I'm not getting any takers on this. But can I suggest something to you? Isn't that what all of us have done? Isn't that what you've done? Isn't that what I've done? The servant came to us, the Holy Spirit in the form of a book that he inspired. That book tells us about the husband to the church. The only thing we know about him is in that book. And he has asked us to travel with him through 300 miles of pirate-infested desert. That's called life, friends. I don't know if you've ever found that out, but that's what life is. 300 miles of pirate-infested desert to go to marry someone we've never seen and to live forever with him in his land. Would you say praise the Lord tonight? There it is. There it is. Now, I've already told you how much water a thirsty camel drinks, and let me jump forward here to the day of Pentecost. I am always moved as I read Acts, the second chapter. Read it just a little while ago, and the Holy Spirit being sent from God to find the church, to find the bride. What's the first thing that Peter did when the anointing of the Holy Spirit came on him? He stood up and he began to preach. 3,000 people, the Bible said, were cut to the heart. Who cut them to the heart? It was the Holy Spirit speaking directly to them. And that, my friend, was the first deposit on the bride. 3,000 people coming into the kingdom of God. A couple of days later, they go to the temple and there's the lame man. They raise him from his crippled condition, and 5,000 are added to the church. And we walk through the pages of the book of Acts, and that is the story of the Spirit of God finding the bride for Christ. It's amazing in chapter 10 of Acts, when the Spirit of God says to Peter, "Don't call what I've cleansed unclean." And he was sent to the Gentiles. We are here tonight because Peter had that impetus from the Holy Spirit. And it's so interesting to watch in the book of Acts how God is moving toward finding his people and finding his bride. And it seems to me that the Spirit has been stirring himself in recent years, and maybe we are not too cognizant of that fact. I read a statement some years ago that right down the road here, isn't the U.S. Center for World Missions somewhere here in Pasadena, right close here? They made a statement back in 1997, and I read it. I didn't believe it. And here's what they said. They said, "More people were born again into the kingdom of God between 1987 and 1997 than had ever been born again from Jesus to 1987. I looked at that and I said, it's impossible. And I called them directly because I didn't believe what they put out. And they said, do the math. Study the demographics. I said, what do you mean? The first question they asked me is, how many people were on the earth when Jesus was here? I'd never thought of that. When I looked back with the demographers, I discovered that they estimate in the entire earth, there were 140 to 160 million people when Jesus was here. It took almost 1,900 years from the time of Jesus till the advent of the 20th century for the world to grow to the first 1 billion people. We came into the 20th century with 1 billion people on the planet. We came out of the 20th century with 6.5 billion people on the planet in 100 years. This is stupendous when you look at it. We've hit a curve. What do you call it? There's a name that I'm looking for here, but anyway, it kind of takes off. And that's what the population of mankind is doing. We've hit that, I'll think about it, exponential, that's the word, the exponential curve. Do you know tonight that 50% of everyone who has ever lived on this earth has been born in the last 50 years? Can I try that again? I will back up these figures. I've researched them. I know what I'm talking about. That means if more people were born in the last 50 years, that means obviously, friends, that there are more Christians on the earth than there are in heaven. Hello? Hello? Think about it. It's amazing. It's going on in our generation. I have a good friend who's a mission statesman. His name is Patrick Johnstone. He wrote Operation World. I spent time with him in London. He's written a book, and it's really challenged me. The name of the book is The Church is Bigger Than You Think. You ought to buy it and read some of what he says. He does a catalog of missions, especially here in the Western world. And in the book, he makes some amazing statements. He said, in the 60s, it appears that the Holy Spirit began to focus particularly on the continent of Africa. He said, in 1900, 2% of Africa was Christian. Today, over 50% of Africa is nominally Christian, somewhere in the neighborhood of 200 million people. This revival's been going on your watch, friends. It's happening while we're alive. He goes on to say, in the 70s, the Spirit seemed to focus on South America. In the year 1900, there were 250,000 evangelicals in South America. Today, In Brazil alone, there are over 60 million believers, more believers in Brazil than all of Europe combined. In the 80s, he said the Spirit focused on Southeast Asia. 100 years ago, there was one church in Southeast Asia. Today, seven of the 10 largest churches in the world are in one Southeast Asian city, Seoul, Korea. I remember preaching in a church, the largest Presbyterian church in the world. It was the seventh service of the day. They'd started at 5 o'clock in the morning. They had, I think it was 15,000 chairs in the auditorium. Every chair was filled for seven services. And we were there at 7 o'clock at night. 40% of South Korea is now Christian. What happened in the 90s? Well, let's look at the communist world. The Holy Spirit began to shake Russia, various communist nations. And those of you who are missionaries and travel know the tremendous work of God being done over there. I had lunch with Rick Renner in Tulsa about 2 weeks ago. Rick tried to join my group, Living Sound, before he ever got into missions, and he couldn't sing, so we told him he couldn't join. But he's done a powerful work for God in missions in Russia right now. In the 90s, 25,000 people a day were coming to Jesus in China. Would somebody say amen? The Catholic Digest says even today there are 10,000 people responding to the gospel. But I would suggest something to you tonight. We are now in a new millennium and a new century. In the second decade of that century. Where's the Holy Spirit going now? I believe 9/11 was an answer for us that most of us never understood. But it's there, and it stands as I don't know the word I'm looking for here. It's like it startled the world to find out that Muslim people hate the West, and they hate our faith, and they hate what we believe in. But in spite of the fact that they hate us, we have a Savior who loves them. And we're going to find them for the kingdom of God. I was in Iraq about five years ago. A lady came up to me, and I'd just spoken in a church meeting in Erbil. And she was so excited. She said, I've just come from the court. She was speaking through a translator, interpreter. I asked her to tell me her story, so she did. She said, Al-Qaeda came to blow my house up 2 years ago. I came out of the house early in the morning, and I heard a noise outside our fence. If you've been over there, all their yards are walled with 6 to 8 foot fences. And she said, I heard a noise, and it was enough to bother me. And she said, we called the security police, and they came to our house. When they looked outside the wall, she said there was a brown bag with 12 pounds of dynamite in it. The dynamite igniter was shoved in the top of the dynamite, but the whatever you call it was severed, was cut. And the police said to her, you're lucky that you're alive because these people meant to kill you. She said the police began a search for the Al-Qaeda people, and she said it's taken 2 years, but they just discovered them 3 days ago. She said, I have just been to the court today to see the men who wanted to kill me. And she said they acknowledged the fact that they were guilty. The judge said that they were going to be committed, or they were going to be executed, and asked her for her opinion, what she thought. She said, No, I don't want them to die. She said, I want them to know about Jesus. And we had a little booklet, 16-page salvation booklet called The Story of Jesus. We had it in her language, and she was carrying a bunch of them in her pocket. And when the judge registered surprise that she didn't want to see the men killed, he said, why would you do that? And she said, well, when Jesus died on the cross, he forgave the people who killed him. And she said, I can only do the same thing. And the judge sat there and his eyes got moist and he said, can I have one of those little booklets as well? Why are we here? Let me bring this to a close. If you follow the story that I began in Genesis 24, the servant meets Rebekah at the well and then goes to her father and brother and tells them how she has fulfilled the prayer that he has prayed. Now, how many of you know the father and the brother? Well, they were excited. They said, it sounds like God does. Go ahead. How many of you think someone should ask the young woman? So they went to the young woman, and here's what they said. They said, will you go with this man? And she said, I will go. There are a lot of people here representing ISOM and the work that you're doing around the world, which I'm so honored to be a part of. This is the word of the Holy Spirit. Will you go with this man? This is the call of God to us as people tonight. The most sacred thing I can do is to go where the Holy Spirit directs me to go. And I would encourage all of you in the years, the 30 years in China, et cetera, et cetera. I would encourage all of you, when we're going with the man, we're going with the plan. And the plan is the evangelization of the world. We're going to be a part of it. In fact, we already are a part of it. But there's something about the Holy Spirit. He's never strident. He's never pushy. In Hebrews, he's called the Spirit of grace. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. And that word led in the Greek is in the ever-present tense. It means for as many as are continually being led, like today, they are the sons of God. We're filling the mandate. That's what we're doing. I've got people in China that we minister to. We've got 3,000 in our Bible study courses there. We've got an orphanage in Burma. We smuggle Bibles into Iran. Boy, that's something. 4 years ago, 5 years ago, two young men met me in the hotel where I was staying in Iraq and said, our father was killed because he wouldn't demand that we renounce Christianity and become Islam, a Muslim. And we have a dream of going back to our land of Iran and filling it with Bibles. I said, how in the world would you do that? And one of them looked at us and he said, you know, all the heroin being developed in Afghanistan is trafficked through and across the nation of Iran. It comes through the mountains between Iran and Iraq, and it's trafficked into Iraq and then from there north into Turkey and into the rest of Europe. I said, how do they get the heroin from Iran into Iraq? And they said, on horseback. I said, really? How many horses? 2,000. How many runs a day? Usually 2. You can only imagine a horse can carry 400 pounds of heroin on its back and saddle. And then he looked at me and he said, it occurred to us, with all that heroin coming into Iraq, that those horses are going back empty. I looked at him, I said, you don't mean what I think you mean, do you? He said, yeah. He said, I've got a drug smuggler coming over to the hotel tomorrow night to talk to you, and we want to make a deal so we can take Bibles on the back of the horses back into Iran. We've just taken 60,000 in, and there's more going. The Holy Spirit has a mandate. And if you hear his heart, and I know many of you do, if you feel his heart and you feel his passion, you have to be involved. You have to get out and do what others are not doing. And I say to those of ISOM who are here tonight, strengthen your hand in the Lord. Understand one thing. You've got the main theme in place. You're doing the right thing for God. You're doing the thing that is the passion on the heart of the Holy Spirit. And we've got to depend on Him for the resources and everything else that's necessary to get the job done, because He is mandated from heaven. I don't think it's long before Jesus comes back. I don't think that at all. In fact, I think it's a very short time. But here's the question from heaven to you. Will you go with the man? Maybe the Holy Spirit has spoken to you about another country. It's never been touched. No one's ever gone. But he's saying to you, I want you to go. Are you willing to do that tonight? Will you go with the man? I went many, many years ago, over 50 years ago, and I'm still going. And you know what? I have no intention of retiring at all. I'm having too much fun doing what I'm doing. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your presence in this room. Thank you for your Holy Spirit who tugs at our heartstrings, who lets us know when we're on target and following after you. But Lord, there may be someone tonight here in this room that doesn't know Jesus, is not following Jesus. And I pray that right now, as the Spirit convicts of sin, just like they were cut to the heart on the day of Pentecost, may the Spirit cut to the heart in this room. And if there's someone that needs you, I pray now that you convict of sin. And if you're here in the room anywhere and you're not walking with the Lord and you want to be, I'd like you to raise a hand right where you are, anywhere in the room. If you'd hold it up so I could see it, please. Hold it high enough for me to see. Yes, I see that. I see that hand. You may take it down. Is there somebody else? Anywhere in the room. I'm going to ask you to stand if you would. If you would stand, you raise your hand. Just stand to your feet if you would. And I want someone to come and stand beside this man and pray with him. In Jesus' name. Praise God. Do it now if you would, please. Go and talk with him. let me say to everybody in the audience, I'm talking to missionaries now and people who may not be called to be missionaries, but you're called to the harvest field because all of us are called. Let's, heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around. Let's ponder this for a moment. Here's the call. Will you go with a man? If you're saying in your heart, I'll go. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord. I'll do what you want me to do. If you're saying that in your heart, would you quietly slip a hand up throughout this auditorium tonight, everywhere? Slip up a hand. Hold it up if you would, please. Pastor, I'm going to ask you to come if you would, please. Let's stand to our feet. Everyone who's holding a hand, just, you're the one, stand to your feet. Just get up around the room, everywhere. I want anyone who's standing close to someone who's standing, reach out, lay your hands on them, pray for them. Bless them in the name of Jesus. And ask God to freshen the call and the burden that he's putting on their heart in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the opportunity of declaring your word tonight. We thank you for your plan. I thank you for Baron and Lisa and all the years they've been doing this, and 340,000 people out there touched. We're grateful, Father. What a harvest, and more to come. More to come. We're willing to go with the man. Everyone that's standing up is saying, we want to go with the man. We want to go with the Holy Spirit. We want to follow him in Jesus' name.